Morning all of you, we will continue with the history chapter, the Indian Mutiny. Okay, so we have done what were the causes of the revolt, in detail we have done, and we were having a look at the main centers and the main leaders of the revolt. We already had a look at Delhi, Kanpur, Lucknow and Jhansi. Today we will have a look at Bareilly. Okay. Now at Bareilly, which was the capital of Rohilakhand, the sepoys, they revolted there and they declared a Rohila chief as the governor, and this governor was in power till the city was finally captured by the Britishers. Then Kumar Singh, he was a 80-year-old landlord of Jagdishpur, so Western Bihar. The revolt was led by an 80-year-old landlord of Jagdishpur. And he was, you know, a very brave leader of his region. So still at 80 years, he was one of the best leaders of that region. And he continued to fight bravely till his death in 1858. And after that, his brother Amar Singh, he took the lead. So after his death, Amar Singh, he led on the work. But so, you know, we studied about some of the leaders of the revolt. We studied about Nana Saheb, Begum Hazrat Mehl, Tatiya Tope, Rani Lakshmi Bai, and also Kumar Singh. But the greatest heroes of this revolt were the thousands of sepoys. Obviously, we don't know their names. Alright, the ones who revolted, we don't know their names. So basically, the greatest heroes of this revolt were the sepoys, the peasants. Peasants means farmers. So the main heroes of this revolt were the sepoys, the peasants and the artisans. Artisans are skilled workers like weaving, basket making, alright, things which you do with your hands. So the artisans and the common people which joined in, the people who all joined in, now they are said to be the real heroes of this revolt. And in many places, you know, even before the sepoys could revolt, so in some places, even before the sepoys could revolt, the common people, they revolted first. And later on, the sepoys, they also revolted. And so because of the participation of the farmers, the artisans and the general population, this revolt, it got its strength from that. And also, it became a popular revolt. Otherwise, you know, it would just have been a sepoy mutiny. If it would have been joined by the farmers, if say farmers have not joined in, and if you know the common people have not joined in, the artisans have not joined in, then it would have remained just a sepoy mutiny. But because other people also joined in, so it became a popular revolt. Okay. Now, you know, in this revolt, the Hindus and the Muslims, they fought together, and you know, they made a very brave effort. But still, you know, this revolt was not successful and it was suppressed by the end of 1858. Now, Delhi was captured by the British by September 1858, and Bahadur Shah, we have already studied about that Bahadur Shah Zafar, you know, he was imprisoned and he was sent to Burma. He was exiled to Burma, and then with his death, you know, when he died in 1862, with that, the Mughal Empire, the Mughal dynasty, it came to an end in India. And his sons, they were also killed by the British in Delhi. Then Nana Saheb, he was defeated by the British, but he did not wanted to surrender to them. So he escaped to Nepal in 1858. And after that, nobody heard about Nana Saheb thereafter. Then in Gwalior, Tatiya Tope, he continued the guerrilla warfare in central India in 1859. Now, guerrilla warfare is a type of warfare which, you know, guerrillas use while they hunt in forest. You know, they hide and all of a sudden they will attack, and then again they will go into hiding. So, he also used that guerrilla warfare technique in central India in 1859, and later on he was betrayed by a zamindar. He was taking refuge, he was taking shelter in the house of one zamindar, and that zamindar betrayed him. He told the Britishers that he is hiding there, so they came and arrested him, and after a quick trial he was hanged in 1859. So Tatiya Tope also died. Then Rani of Jhansi, we studied about her also, that she died fighting. So while she was fighting, she died on the battlefield only. And so what we can say is that by 1859, all the important leaders of the revolt, they were either dead or they were captured by the Britishers. Then John Lawrence and Campbell, though they were British commanders, and you know, they showed by their exemplary courage, means exemplary means which can be taken as an example, means they fought back with so much courage and with such good military techniques and brought the situation under control for the Britishers. And now, you know, after the Britishers, they were able to suppress the movement. Then they took stern steps, very strict steps, to teach the people a lesson, Indian people a lesson, so that they will not do anything like this ever again. Means they will not revolt against the Britishers again. And so, you know, the Britishers also remembered that, you know, at some places, the British officials, they were treated very badly during this revolt. So they remembered everything. And then they tried to teach a lesson, or you can say that they tried to take revenge on the Indian people. And so, you know, now they had power in their hands also, and now they took to inhuman treatment of the rebels, and they executed many of them. Hundreds of people, they lost their lives, and even the common people, they were not spared. And villages, means whole villages, they were burned, they were bombed from the air, they were burned, and people were mercilessly punished. Some of the rebels, you know, they were tied to the mouth of the cannons and they were blown off. Cannon, you know? Alright? So they were even tied to the mouth of the cannons and they were blown off. Now, all this was done to, you know, create a fear in the hearts and minds of the Indians so that they will not revolt again in future. So, you know, the revolt was a failure, but then what were the causes of the failure of the revolt? Now, East India Company, they had a better war plan as compared to the Indian sepoys. So, they had a better war plan and obviously, you know, better planning. So, they had an advantage over the Indians. Then, the East India Company, they had a better trained and better equipped army. Here, the sepoys, they did not have any arms and ammunition. What to fight back with? But the Britishers, you know, they have the latest weapons also, and they were also a well-trained army. So that was also one of the reasons of the failure. Then the Indian sepoys, you know, they lacked leadership. There was no proper leadership. Though we have studied about some of the leaders of the revolt, but you know, these leaders, they led the revolt in their own areas. Like in Jhansi, Lakshmibai, she led the revolt. In Bihar, Kumar Singh, he led the revolt. But you know, there was no one national leader who emerged and you know, who combined everything and took the movement further. So there was no one like that. Later on, you know, when Gandhiji, he emerged on the scene, so he emerged as a national leader and he combined the revolts of all the people he brought together, and you know, then at that time obviously we were successful in getting independence. So there was no proper leadership. Then many of the Indian, mainly the upper section of the society, the zamindars, the rich people, higher communities, and the higher castes also, they supported the Britishers. They did not support the Indians, their own people, but they supported the Britishers. Then many Indians, you know, they became selfish. They were scared of the Britishers, so they thought that no, this is not affecting us, so we will not participate in the revolt. So they were scared and they did not participate in the revolt. They did not join the revolt. So these are some of the causes of the failure. Now, this revolt of 1857 is one of the important events in the history of our country. And now this revolt, you know, it came as a shock for the Britishers also. They were not expecting anything like this. They never thought that people would come up and revolt in such a way. So this revolt of 1857, it shook the foundations of the British Empire in India. And you know, after they were able to suppress the revolt, then Queen Victoria, she brought out a proclamation. Now, proclamation is an official announcement. So she brought out an official announcement, and this was to pacify, means to calm down the Indians, to, you know, to remove the anger from the people here, and also to make the Indian people or to make the Indian people convinced that you know it is okay now, no longer we will be doing anything like this and your interests are safe with us, means we will work for your welfare. So they try to pacify the Indians, make them calm and happy, and like bring back their faith in the British rule. So that was the proclamation all about. And you know, certain changes were made in the administration also after this revolt. And so after this revolt, what happened? Till now, the English East India Company, the trading company which came to trade with India, that was ruling. But now the rule of English East India Company came to an end, and all the powers were now transferred to the British crown or the British Parliament. Now the British Parliament was responsible for ruling over India. Till now, East India Company was ruling. And so, through a special law, the board of directors and the board of control, those who were earlier involved in ruling over India, they were abolished and their place was taken by a new person, a new designation, which was called as Secretary of State. So a Secretary of State for India, this position was made, and this person was assisted by India Council, which consisted of 15 members. Then the army was also reorganized. Earlier we started during the course of this chapter that for one European there were 5 Indians, alright, in the British army, 5 Indian sepoys. But later on what they did, they tried to increase the number of the Europeans also. Like in some places they did 3 to 5, like for every 3 Europeans 5 Indians, in some places it was like 2 to 5. So they tried to increase the number of the Europeans also, so that even they were there in proper numbers, and all the important posts and all the important artillery, machinery, the weapons, they were placed in the hands of the Britishers after this revolt. Okay. Then the policy of ruthless conquest, you know, we have seen that many of the governor generals, the British governor generals, you know, they tried to bring more and more territory under their control. Like we studied about Clive, remember? Yes, Battle of Plassey. So, you know, he wanted to bring Bengal under his control. So, you know, he tried to bring more parts. Then we also studied about Lord Dalhousie, his doctrine of lapse. And then, you know, Awadh also was annexed to the British Empire because they said that the Nawab was not governing well. So he was not able to govern his territory well. So we are taking control of that. And we studied about the doctrine of lapse, that if any ruler, he did not have a real son or daughter, so their kingdom will become a part of the British Empire. So now they stopped doing all this. Alright, they stopped making the Indian rulers their enemy. So they stopped this, and now with the end of East India Company's rule, so you know, suppression of the revolt, this we already talked about in 1858. A new phase emerged in the history of the British rule in India, and there were very important changes in the policy towards India, administrative changes also. And this already I told you that the British Parliament, it passed a law, and according to that the rule of English East India Company, it came to an end. British Crown now was responsible for administration and governing of India, and the position of Governor General, now it was changed, means the Governor General now was called as Viceroy. So earlier he was called as Governor General, but now they were called as Viceroy. And this Viceroy, he was a representative of the British Parliament or the British Crown. British Crown means the British monarch or the British king or queen. Okay, so that was the chapter. Have you all understood? Yes, here also? Okay, so let's do the exercises. You people will help me to do this. I will not tell you all the answers. Which are not there in the book, that I will tell you. But the others you need to tell. First one, choose the correct option. The British rule brought drastic changes to the lives of - Indians. Poor, rich, both of these, none of these. Right, both of these. Because you know, not only poor, the rich were also affected. The zamindars were removed from their places. The rulers also, the Nawabs, the Rajas, they were also removed from their places. So, rich and poor, both. Western education exposed Indians to the new thoughts of liberty, equality, both of these or none of these?
Ma'am, none of these.
Yes. Western education, you know, in Western education, people already have started talking about liberty, freedom and equality, that everyone should be treated equally. So obviously when this was introduced in India, Western education, so with that, you know, we got to study about the new philosophers also, the reformers also, the things which people were talking about in the world. So through that we got these ideals also. So it is both of these, both of these. After the Meerut mutiny, the rebels moved to, from Meerut they went to Delhi, right? Who was declared as the Emperor of India during the revolt of 1857? Who was called as the Emperor? Emperor of India. The sepoys, they went from Meerut to Delhi. Whom did they declare as the Emperor or the leader of the revolt? Right. Bahadur Shah II. He is called as Bahadur Shah Zafar. So Bahadur Shah II. Begum Hazrat Mahal led the revolt at? Lucknow? At Lucknow. Okay, now this exercise I will help you do. Identify the following people or places of events. Places or events. The sepoys of Awadh, they were infuriated, means they were very angry by this event and they joined the uprising. Annexation of Awadh. Second is, this is the place where the first act of rebellion took place. This you will tell. Where did the first act of rebellion took place? Which was the first place where the sepoys rebelled about these grease cartridges? Tell me. First place.
Meerut.
Yes? No, not Meerut. Before Meerut. Who was the first one to refuse to use the grease cartridges? Who was the first person? Mangal Pandey, which place was that? Where did he refuse to use? It is Barrackpore. He was the actual leader of the rebels in Delhi. Actual leader in Delhi. He was also the leader of the Mughal army. What was his name? No. He was proclaimed. He was the leader of the Mughal army at Bareilly. Bakht Khan. Right. Then these were the people who made the revolt a popular one. Who made it a popular revolt? Sepoys were there. Along with sepoys, whom did we have? Peasants. Then artisans and general population, common people. Okay, next. The Mughal dynasty ended with this event. After what event did Mughal dynasty came to an end? I told you just now. After what happened did Mughal dynasty came to an end?
Mom, death of Bahadur Shah Zafar.
Right, death of Bahadur Shah. So Bahadur Shah Zafar's death. Adopted son of Peshwa Bajirao II. Then Bentinck and Dalhousie. Bentinck and Dalhousie. Confiscation of jagirs. Confiscation of jagirs. Next, Sanyasi revolt. Right, Sanyasi, fakirs and peasants. Then Jhansi. Rani Lakshmi Bai and commander of Nana Sahib. I have left one, huh? Hindu and Muslim sepoys. Hindu and Muslim sepoys. Greased cartridges. Okay, so Sanyasi revolt is Sanyasi, fakirs and peasants. Hindu and Muslim sepoys is greased cartridges. Jhansi is Rani Lakshmi Bai and commander of Nana Sahib. Tatya Tope. Alright, and let's move on to the next exercise. Say if the sentences are true or false. The revolt of 1857 broke out in a sudden and spontaneous manner. What is a sudden revolt? Was it sudden or not? Yes. On the very first page we did it, that it was not a sudden revolt. People had been angry with the British rule. They had been dissatisfied, discontented with the British rule for about 100 years by now. So it is false. The British forced Indians to sell cheap and buy dear. Means to sell their raw materials cheap and buy the finished goods at high prices. Dear is costly. Yes, is it true or false? It is true. Artisans were patronized by the new British rulers. Did the new British rulers patronize the Indian artisans? Like the Indian Rajas and the Nawabs. In their courts, many musicians and artists and these religious people, they also used to live. And the kings and the Nawabs, they used to take care of their needs. So did the Britishers do the same? No, so this is false. The Indian rulers were quite satisfied with Lord Dalhousie's expansionist policies. Were the Indian rulers satisfied? No, this is false. The revolt of 1857 started as a mutiny of sepoys in the company's army. Did it start as a mutiny? Yes, it did. The revolt in Lucknow was led by Nana Sahib. False. It was led by? In Lucknow, the revolt was led by? Begum Hazrat Mahal. Right. Okay. So, this completes the exercises of this chapter. And the question answers I will send you in the form of PDF. Okay. So, that you can do at home today.